You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Keith Schaefer, editor and publisher of the Oil and Gas Investments Bulletin. Merry Christmas, Keith.
Merry Christmas, Jim.
Best of the season to you and your family. I am wondering what's happening with oil. All of a sudden, a big price jump?
Yeah, today was a really interesting day. We had one of our first big withdrawals of oil from storage in the United States, which the last several weeks has been surprisingly strong builds. A year ago when this whole thing happened, we were supposed to see U.S. oil production cut way back, and all of a sudden prices would rocket back up again on the back of lower U.S. production. But that has not happened. So it's been a pretty rare week when we actually saw production decline and inventories decline. And so this week we only saw inventories decline, not production, but still a very good sign. We had there was about 6 million. We used up about 6 million barrels out of storage, Jim. So we're still very close to record levels, but not so bad.
Now that's interesting that you take oil out of storage and it actually boosts the price at the wellhead. How does that work?
Oh, well, you know, it's, despite the fact that there's still, I mean, buckets of storage, unbelievable amounts of storage, you know, we're closing in on 500 million barrels storage in the United States. So 6 million barrels is truly a drop in the bucket. But the way the market works, Jim, is the market has to make money on every little bit of data in the energy markets these days. It's just crazy. It's insane how prices gyrate over each little data point. And so on this one here, trader psychology is, oh, well, we're going to start to run out of oil finally here, and here's the turn, so let's go buy oil now. And it's just really a greater fool theory is what it is. Fundamentally, there's nothing that really says oil should move a penny today.
They're just desperate for higher prices?
Everybody's desperate for higher prices, Jim. Oh, my God. You could hardly believe the amount of money that has been poured into the oil ETFs down in the States, particularly USO, on the New York. It's just, it has increased the amount of money in that ETF probably by triple in the last year. It's just unbelievable. People are trying to time the bottom, saying, hey, oil's got to come back. It has to come back, which, of course, is true. Timing that's just crazy.
Now, of course, does this mean that they have loads of cash to invest in something and they want to invest?
Oh, Jim, but this is almost going to be all retail investors. And retail investors are suckers. So when I see that much money pouring into an oil ETF, that to me, that's a very bearish sign. So it tells me that we're probably not close to a bottom. And until people just kind of forget about oil and give up hope on oil, then I think we'll start to be able to start getting ready to call a bottom. But, oh, it's, a lot of people lost a lot of money trying to call a bottom in oil this year.
And people who follow cycles say this is not over. They can see oil in the 20s.
Right. And so you look at some of my colleagues on the newsletter side, Donald Doney over at the Technical Speculator, he's a big believer that commodities move in 18-year cycles, and we're only into like year two or three. So, and you know, worst case scenario, or I guess best case scenario, is you'd argue March 11 was the top, and so we're only four and a half years into that. So, yeah, these cycles come and go, but certainly on a short-term basis, Jim, it's almost impossible to guess where oil's going.
And is that a good reason for people to stay away from it?
Well, when you look at the amount of money that's been lost, absolutely, you're right, because people are trying to game the system and get an edge and make up their own minds on different things. And my attitude's always been, let's just ignore the first 15-20% move and then wait till a firm trend has been established and we'll catch the big part of the move. But, you know, to miss that, everybody wants to catch that first 10-15% and make themselves look smart. And I don't have that kind of ego.
Are the big energy companies starting to look at other energy sources besides oil? I think somebody just made a $200 million investment in a wind farm in Germany, one of the big major companies.
Could be. Well, certainly they've been moving towards gas in a big way. Like Exxon and Shell would be the poster childs for everyone moving towards natural gas versus oil. And I'm pretty confident in saying that Shell has close to 50% of their reserves now in natural gas. So, but there's no doubt that some of these groups are moving towards some renewables. It just makes sense that nobody really knows how far this trend is going to go or how fast it's going to go towards renewables. Right now it's very popular because of the COP21 Paris conference. So it just makes sense that these guys are going to, for them to drop $200 million, Jim, is nothing. They go spend the money, then they put all their people on it, figure out the economics, the operations, the logistics, and they start to get ready for tomorrow, because who knows?
I remember we talked about Shell moving that giant oil platform to the Arctic. It had already cost them $7 billion, and then recently they said, no, we're not going to go after it now. Again, could they afford $7 billion?
Well, no, I don't think anybody can afford $7 billion, but, you know, who knows what they learned that the next time they go back there that they don't find a different way to do things a little bit better. So it's all good education, I guess.
And you're also a person who's been very high on technology in the oil field, and you're saying that before, when they used to send out 100 guys to get so much oil, now they can send out a team of 12 and be three times as productive. So we'll probably never see the same numbers of oil workers that we did in the past.
They're seeing an increasing automation for sure, both in the fracking and in the drilling. So, yeah, and certainly in the production side. So, and that's one of the beautiful things about oil, Jim, is that once you spend a whole bunch of money getting it and finding it and setting up the infrastructure, you hardly have to touch it again, and it'll flow for 20 years and make you a lot of money. So you look at these big offshore platforms, my God, they cost as much as, you know, several hundred million dollars, but then they only need 30 guys to run it. So there's a lot of profit opportunity for a lot of years there.
Yeah, and they keep telling us robots are going to be taking over more and more jobs as well.
Could be, yep.
And, I mean, one of the big examples would be those giant trucks that they drive. The operators right now get $200,000 a year. The new trucks that have been ordered will be capable to be run by robots.
Well, last year they might have made $200,000, but I can tell you, I'm pretty confident saying this year they won't be making $200,000. But you're right, Jim. It's definitely a trend, and it's moving forward. And as has been the case in a lot of other industries, the job creation is actually going to be in the mechanization and supporting all that mechanization.
Support workers, maintenance workers.
That's right. You know, getting to know your robotics, those kind of guys.
Yeah, although while the robots are doing the job, someone's still got to fix the robots and program them.
Exactly.
And so there will be jobs, just not as many.
That seems to be the case. You know, it's a manufacturing business, and all throughout manufacturing, in different verticals, there has been a mechanization here, and I would expect that to continue in energy as well.
Has the low Canadian dollar helped oil producers at all to survive?
Oh, absolutely. My God. The reality is that, you know, we're still getting, we're over $1.33 right now. So, you know, oil today is, $37. So a third of that is $12. So we're getting $48, and the Americans, you know, we're getting $40 in our currency, and they're getting obviously less. So, no, it's been a big difference. Though I would tell you, Jim, that right now, really, you're starting to see a lot more bankruptcies. So even with the lower Canadian dollar, it's held off a lot of bankruptcies, but now they're starting to happen. So there's almost one a week in Calgary now. So it has helped for this last year, but I think it's kind of delayed the inevitable, and I think that's why you're seeing OPEC continue to keep their boots on our necks for another 6 to 12 months, because they really need industry to cry uncle, and the lower Canadian dollar has really saved, I would think, particularly the oil sands producers, because the reality is that our labor is a lot more expensive than the Americans, and so now you've got this dollar difference that's really kind of helped their economics out and helped them survive this year.
The Middle Eastern countries used to be rather subtle when it came to attacking the North American oil industry, but now they don't even hide their efforts to attack it, do they?
No, they don't. And, you know, I don't know that they were ever, what I'd say, be attacking, because the U.S. shale revolution just happened so fast. Like, the U.S. increased oil production probably 90% in just 6 years. And so when they just saw the continued unbridled growth here on what is generally high-cost production, that's when they kind of said, after 5 years in November 14, okay, enough is enough. And they were subtle in being willing to accommodate the market. Like when Libya went offline, they increased production 1 million barrels a day. And at different times they had cut back a little bit, but they just saw the writing on the wall that there was no way they were going to be able to slow the U.S. juggernaut unless it had a shock to its system. So they got it.
And what's going to happen when Iran really turns on the taps?
Well, there's a good chance there that, you know, we start to see Brent traded a meaningful discount to WTI if that happens. You know, like I say, this was the first week we started to see a real draw in U.S. inventories. And if another million barrels or 750,000 barrels a day comes on from Iran and another quarter to half million comes on out of Libya, which is now looking increasingly more likely, you know, Brent could trade at the regular $2 to $3 a barrel discount that it used to for years and years and years before the shale revolution.
Is that good or bad news?
I don't think it's, for American producers, it's going to be good news. For refiners, it'll be bad news. And for pipelines, it shouldn't make much of a difference. So downstream will be bad, midstream will be even, I would say, and upstream it should be good news.
What's going to happen with natural gas this year? I mean, I'm told that they're expecting it to be 22 degrees Celsius in New York for New Year's Eve.
Yeah, it's going to be 74 on Christmas Eve in Washington. So, yeah, natural gas prices are really challenged right now, Jim. They're sitting here at $1.90. They've come off from the support at 260 down to support at 230. Now they're sitting here. They traded as low as, I think, $1.65. Certainly Canadians now are getting about $1.60 with the U.S. dollar. So the gas industry has been dealing with low prices for such a long time. They've actually done a pretty decent job in reducing their costs. So there is some guys, both in Canada and the States, that have costs under $1 in MCF. But they're few and far between. So right now, only the best of the best are making any cash flow. And because of El Nino, where the eastern waters of the Pacific, and those are the waters that are close to North America, because those waters are so warm right now, that's translating into, strangely enough, a very warm east coast as opposed to a very warm west coast. So that has meant that in the big populated area of North America, there's no natural gas demand. In fact, we're talking about natural gas demand being down by as much as 10 BCF a day. 10 billion cubic feet a day, and the U.S. only produces 75 billion cubic feet a day, so that's a meaningful number. And so storage here in the United States and Canada is staying at almost record highs. So gas could really get ugly come the shoulder season. If we don't see, what we've seen the last 2 years, Jim, is a very cold February, March. If we don't see that this year, gas could truly go no bid on some days in the spring shoulder season.
Wow.
Like zero. And we're already seeing negative pricing at some hubs around North America, particularly in Canada. Those are just the small hubs right now, but everybody's feeling the pain.
We'll have more with Keith Schaefer right after the break.
See singing impressionist Andre Philippe Gagnon.
And I think to myself.
In Oliver, December 29th. In Kelowna, December 30th. Buy online and save at OnTourTickets.com. Unbelievable harmonies, spectacular performance, the ultimate tribute to the Everly Brothers and Simon and Garfunkel. Bird Dog and the Vintage Electric Band, Saturday, January 9th at the Alex Goulden Hall. Buy online and save at OnTourTickets.com.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Keith Schaefer. Keith, it's not all doom and gloom in the crude oil and energy business. Can you tell us about maybe some success stories?
Oh, well, I guess the one thing that seems to have happened here in the last 2 weeks is that the high yield market got really, really scared and created a panic bottom last week, the last 2-3 weeks. So you're seeing all these, pipeline companies, oil tanker companies, LNG shippers, they all had a big, big spike down. So what we did last week, Jim, is we actually bought some of these companies. We finally bought a big company called Enbridge, one of the biggest pipeline companies in North America. This was a stock that was trading $70, $80 for years, and now dipped as low as $40. So we bought some of that, and these things are rebounding really nicely. I'm sorry, Enbridge really only got to about the 60s, not the 80s. And another company would be Golar Partners, and the symbol on that one is GMLP on the NASDAQ. So what happened last week, for example, is that one of the bigger shipping companies in the world called TK, and strangely enough, they're actually based out of here in Vancouver, they reduced their dividends dramatically on all their publicly listed companies, which, and there's about five or six of them in that stable. And so Golar, who is in much better shape financially, they also got crushed almost 50% that day. So we were buying stock down in that company at 8.25, and today it got as high as 13.50. So like that's like a 60% jump in just a week. So that's when you're able to buy fear, and you know what you're talking about. Like, I've been studying these Golar stocks since December 2010. I've talked to management and traded them for the most part successfully, but not always. And so when you can buy fear and get that kind of a lift, they like, that stock's paying me a 28% dividend now, Jim. 28%. So that's the kind of things when you specialize in one sector year after year, you start to just get to understand things, and you can take advantage of some of the, what's the word I'm looking for, some of the stretched market conditions from time to time.
Now, one of the things that my friends keep asking me is, Jim, they say oil prices are at an 11-year low, yet at least in the Vancouver area, gasoline prices remain quite high. Why the difference? And is there a margin there that an investor could take advantage of?
Not really, no. The reality is the Canadian dollar is the biggest culprit, Jim. Like, we're about $1.22, $1.24 here in Vancouver. And if we had, so our dollar right now is about $1.71. So that's like a buck. I transferred some money today at $1.34. So that's over a third. So that's over 40 cents. That's about 41 cents. So if we had the Canadian dollar at par like it was 2 years ago, gas today would be 80 cents a liter, not $1.24. 80 cents.
Wow. What a difference. So consumers don't think a lower dollar makes a big difference domestically, but it does.
Huge. And then you take the 15 cent a liter, Vancouver municipal tax, the largest in North America, and all of a sudden you're down to 65 cents. 65 cents a liter, Jim.
Well, what can we do to boost the Canuck buck? I know. Boost
Get oil
prices.
Higher.
Yes.
we're stuck in this catch 22, Jim, because we're viewed as a petrocurrency. Now, the good news is that as the oil price rises, we should not actually see that much difference in our gasoline prices, because the rising Canadian dollar is going to absorb the shock of any rising oil price.
That is good news, because I was worried about that myself.
I'm not promising it's going to happen, but I'd like to think that's what should happen.
Keith, anything else you wanted to add before we go to the Christmas break?
Jim, I just want to wish everybody a happy Merry Christmas and a joyous New Year. Our portfolio actually was about flat on the year, which I thought was a major accomplishment. And next year, we're kind of ready for both if oil jumps up again or if it doesn't. So stay tuned, everybody, and we'll try and keep you abreast of what's happening in the oil patch.
Keith, the best of everything to you and your family.
God bless, Jim.
My guest has been Keith Schaefer, editor and publisher of the Oil and Gas Investments Bulletin, the website oilandgas-investments.com. You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio. Find us on Twitter at Talk Digital Net. Check out our YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. Comments or questions for the show can be sent to info@HowStreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard.
Comments made on HowStreet.com Radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. HowStreet.com Radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.